And today we have, I think, a really, really important message. It's entitled simply, Why It Matters. Why It Matters. We have on our screen two very contrasting men. On the left, you see a picture of Adolf Hitler. On the right, you see a picture of Franklin Roosevelt, President of the United States, at the time that Hitler was Chancellor of Germany. Did these two men think a lot alike, or would you say they had some very different ideological thinkings? They had quite different ideas, didn't they, about how this world could be run and how a nation could be governed. Why did they have these differences? What was the difference between these two men? It wasn't simply because Hitler was small and had a mustache and Roosevelt had polio. There was something very uniquely different about those men. If we go to our next slide, we see a picture of Joseph Stalin on the left and Harry Truman, President Truman that succeeded Roosevelt on the right. Again, these men had very different ideas about things. Very different ideas. But maybe you might be more familiar with the next set of pictures. We have here on the left a picture of Martin Luther, a statue of Luther actually, and on the right, Pope Leo X. You remember who Pope Leo X was? He was the one who issued the bull, disfellowshipping or excommunicating Luther. He was the one who declared Luther was a heretic. But I ask you a question. They were both men, weren't they? They both belonged to the Roman Catholic Church at that time. What was so fundamentally different about these men? The only known time that Martin Luther King Jr. and Malcolm X ever met was recorded in the photograph you see here in slide number 5. Martin Luther King, a professed Christian, evangelical. Malcolm X, leader of the Nation of Islam in America. Very radically different ideas. Both black men, both came from interesting backgrounds that weren't terribly different in a lot of ways. But yet there were great differences. What was the difference between those two men? Let me make this a little easier in our next slide. On our left picture, we have a picture of M.L. Andreessen. You ever hear of M.L. Andreessen? Is there anyone here who hasn't ever heard of Andreessen? And on the right, Walter Martin. Have you heard of Walter Martin? Two very conflicting men in many respects. Why? What made the difference in these men? What is the difference, if you please, between the papacy and the Advent movement, if I could ask that? What is the fundamental difference? They're both composed of people. They both have worldwide projects and ideas. They both have a message they want to give to the world. Seems like there's a lot of things alike. But friends, there are some things that are fundamentally different. And they're just as fundamentally different as Luther was from Leo, as Stalin was from Truman, as Hitler was from Roosevelt, or Martin Luther King Jr. was from Malcolm X. The difference was what they believed to be their moral compass and how they followed that compass. Did you get that? The difference was what their moral compass was and how they determined to follow that compass. Recently, we all know that there's been some meetings with a desire to bring unity to a fragmenting group. And they have advocated, and some have advocated, that we should be checking our doctrines or checking your doctrines at the door before you come in. Some have said, and I quote this next one, we are praying that this conference will bring unity to the believers in love, allowing differences of opinions and still retain a respect for opinion. Well, friends, of course, as Christians, we respect everyone's opinion. True Christian liberty gives freedom of conscience. We don't deny anyone the ability to believe whatever they want. If you want to believe that the moon is made of green cheese and that men from Mars are little green guys, you can believe that. No one's going to persecute you for that here. We don't agree with that, just like we don't agree with Pope Leo X. We don't agree with a lot of things. But friends, this idea that we are to be in unity in love. This idea that we are to be in unity in love. This is a red herring. This is something that's designed to take our eyes and our minds away from the real issues. Because the Bible speaks about unity, it sure does. And it speaks about love, and it sure does. But it speaks about a unity of the faith. And that unity of the faith, friends, can only happen in truth. And love is truth. And if we claim that we're just going to get together because of love and check our doctrines, our teachings at the door, friends, then you know what? There's no need for men like Hitler and Roosevelt to have any variances. There was no reason for Stalin and Truman to have any differences. There was no reason for Luther and Leo to have any differences. Or Martin Luther King Jr. and Malcolm X, or anyone else down the line you want to look at. Why don't we just go to the Pope and say, look here, you know what? The Bible says love all men. We just want to love you. We want to be good to you. We'll give you a medal of our church. Oh, by the way, we did that too. Yes. You know that, don't you? Mm-hmm. You sure did. Retired B.B. Beach, Secretary of the General Conference, gave the Pope a gold medallion. Sure did. Not this current Pope, Pope Paul. While true Christian liberty forces nobody to believe in anything, unity is not found in so-called love, but in truth, for true love is based in truth. I want you to turn with me in your Bibles to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 13. The Apostle Paul writes, and he says, but we are bound to give thanks always to God for you, brethren, beloved of the Lord, because God hath from the beginning chosen you to salvation through sanctification of the Spirit and belief of the truth. I think that this is telling us something. That belief of the truth is important, friends, because sanctification comes through truth. It doesn't come just simply through sincerity. Did you get that? In other words, we can be sincere all we so may want, friends. The Apostle Paul was sincere when he was on the Damascus Road persecuting Christians, but he was also wrong, and he was in error. Doctrine, friends, doctrine. And the word that you find in your Bible, translated doctrine, the word in the original language, simply means teachings. The things that we teach, the things that we believe, the things that form the core skeleton of our religious experience. We call this doctrine. These are our teachings. And doctrines affect our life. It has been so accurately said, so truly said, that you don't rule your beliefs rule you. And I tell you, friends, that's more true than maybe even the person who likes to say that a lot believes it and understands it to be. But it is true, friends. Our beliefs rule us. They affect us. They change whoever we are. And if we have doctrines that are erroneous, then they have an effect upon us as a people. Look at the difference between Hitler and Roosevelt. One believed in totalitarianism, the other believed in democracy. And it ruled, it determined their actions and what they were going to do. Ellen G. White has stated this in Volume 5 of the Testimonies on page 292. She says, error is never harmless. It never sanctifies, but always brings confusion and dissension. It is always dangerous. Did you get that last part especially? When is error safe? It's not. It's always dangerous. Error is never harmless. But friends, it's okay, we're told, to check your doctrines at the door. You can hold on to your error. We're just going to love everybody in unity. Friends, I want to tell you, that's a sloppy agape. That makes no sense at all. Jesus didn't come to this earth and die on the cross of Calvary so that we could stay in error. Not at all. Not at all. No one would say, it doesn't matter what God you serve as long as you are sincere and love others. Or, well, maybe sometimes they do, but they shouldn't say that. The God of Islam, the God of Malcolm X, was not the same as the God of Martin Luther King Jr. By the way, you know Martin Luther King Jr., he was named after Martin Luther because his dad actually went to Germany. He had a different name, and he was so impressed by Martin Luther, toured the castle and where Luther stayed there, to Wartburg, and was so impressed, he changed his name to Martin Luther, legally changed it to Martin Luther, and then when his son was born, he gave him the name Martin Luther King Jr. But friends, the God of the Dalai Lama is not the God of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It does matter. Now, sometimes people think, well, you know, religion is like diet. What you eat really doesn't affect you. Oh, really? Does eating this affect our health? Sure does, doesn't it? Does eating something like this affect our health? You know, here this is a picture of a lobster. The first one's a picture of a pig on a spit, roasting. These things affect our health a lot. And sincerity is a virtue, but it is not the test of sound doctrine. God wills, friends, that His truth be known. And lest you think that somehow He's going to hide it from you or you're not able to find it, may I remind you, as it says in the book Christ Object Lessons, that all His biddings are enablings. And that's true whether it means overcoming sin, understanding His will, following His purposes, or whatever. How did Joshua view these matters? Joshua was a great man in the Old Testament. He was one of only two men who entered into that wilderness as a man and left alive. In Joshua chapter 24, if you would turn with me to Joshua chapter 24, verses 14 and 15. Now therefore, fear the Lord and serve Him in sincerity. Well, sincerity is good, isn't it? It's not wrong of itself, but friends, it has to be mingled with what else?
Truth.
With truth. Now therefore, fear the Lord and serve Him in sincerity and in truth. And put away the gods which your fathers served on the other side of the flood and in Egypt, and serve ye Yahweh. Serve ye the Lord. And if it seem evil unto you to serve Yahweh, choose you this day whom you will serve, whether the gods which your fathers served that were on the other side of the flood, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land ye dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Now we might not think that we're going to serve a god of stone or wood or some other god today. But friends, we have been told in spirit prophecy that when we have a false conception of God and we worship a false conception of God, that we are as verily worshiping a false god as were these Canaanite people. That's right. Because after all, none of the false gods in reality exist, do they? Moloch, Ashtaroth, Baal. There's no such thing as these gods who serve and live someplace in an inferior place outside of heaven. Friends, they're all figments of our imaginations. They're all just ideas. Ideas about someone that people worship. They don't exist at all. There's only one true God. Only one true God. His biddings are enablings, friends, and we can worship that true God, and it does make a difference, because Jesus said in John chapter 7, verse 17, if any man will do His will, he shall know the doctrine, whether it be of God or whether I speak of myself. We can know. And this doctrine does have an effect upon us and all that we do. But how do we then determine what is right and what is wrong? How do we make these determinations? Well, you know, in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 21, the Apostle Paul says to prove all things, right? Sometimes we become a little closed-minded and we don't want to investigate matters. Now, I'm not suggesting that we have to investigate matters multiple times. If you've investigated and know what the Bible says about witchcraft, you don't need to investigate it again, right? Someone comes to you with a new argument for Sunday worship, you don't need to investigate it again. You've already proven it to be false. But the Bible says we are to prove all things, hold fast that which is good. And how do we prove them? How do we know? What is the standard by which they are tested then? Isaiah chapter 8, verse 20 tells us it is to the law and to the testimony that they speak not according to this words, because there's no light in them. So friends, we may find other sources that seem to have information that's helpful. And sometimes we do find sources that have helpful information. But friends, nothing takes a place or is the standard compared to the Word of God.
Amen.
Only the Word of God can be that true, final, full standard. And the Bible has a word for false teachings. Did you know that? It's in Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 14. The Apostle Paul here is speaking about gifts that have been given to the church and the purpose of these gifts. And part of it is found in verse 14, that we henceforth be no more children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine. Calls them what?
Wind.
A wind of doctrine. A wind of doctrine. And you know, the Bible speaks about this wind. In the book of Jeremiah, if we turn there, Jeremiah chapter 5 and verse 13. And the prophets shall become wind, and the word is not in them. Thus shall it be done unto them. He's talking about these false prophets in these days, and he says there's wind in them. And he equates this with the fact that they don't have his word. And so when we hear false doctrines, these are winds of doctrine because, friends, they don't have the word of God with them. And that's where they are failing. Now, the Apostle Paul, who was a stickler for doctrine. You know, sometimes people think Paul spoke all this stuff about grace. Well, grace is a doctrine. He spoke all this stuff about faith. Well, faith is a doctrine. But Paul also spoke about obedience. He spoke about a lot of things. But he believed in doctrine. And two of his understudies, if you please, Timothy and Titus, he specifically wrote to these young ministers about doctrine and the importance of sound doctrine, the importance of good doctrine. Turn with me, if you would, first to 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 16. Paul says, "For all Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for what?
Doctrine,
for teaching. You see, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished in all good works." Friends, if you want to understand perfection, if you want to achieve that which God wants you to have, then doctrine becomes part of the program. In 1 Timothy chapter 4, verses 13 through 16, Paul says, "Till I come, give attention to reading, to exhortation, to doctrine. Neglect not the gift that is in thee, which was given thee by prophecy, with the laying on of the hands of the presbytery. Meditate upon these things, give thyself wholly to them, that thy profiting may appear to all. Take heed unto thyself and unto the doctrine. Continue in them, for in doing this thou shalt both save thyself and them that hear thee." Is it important?
Yes.
Friends, it is vitally important. It is very important. In 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 1 and 2. Oh, I like this verse. Paul says, "I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. Preach the word." I hope I said that loud enough you got it. Preach what?
Word.
"Preach the word, be instant, in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort with all long suffering and
doctrine.
Preach the word." Now this last week, I got my Sproutomatic out and I made some sprouts. Got a picture of some sprouts here. These aren't the ones I made, but I made some sprouts by God's grace. I found out most of my seed, I think, is bad because only a little bit of it sprouted, but the seed's several years old and so it's probably lost its vitality. Sprouts are good and sprouts are a wonderful thing. Maybe you like the juice. We have a picture here of the famous Norwalk juicer making some juice. But I want to tell you, friends, God, listen to me, God did not tell Timothy through Paul to preach sprouts. He didn't say to preach juicing. Sprouts have their place. Juicing has its place. We had a sprouts class here a few weeks ago. It was a real nice little class. I was really glad to be a part of it. But friends, that's not what we do on Sabbath morning. That's not what preaching is about. Preaching is about the Word of God. Now, part of the Word of God is healthy living. There's no problem with that. But friends, when we focus everything on sprouts or juicing or something else outside of the Word of God, we're in the wrong place. We're in the wrong place. I don't apologize that for saying that. The Sabbath school class, the worship hour, it should be about the Word of God. It should be filled with the Word of God. Even the songs we sing, they should be filled with the Word of God. Titus chapter 2, verses 1 through 7. "But speak thou the things which become" what? Sound doctrine. Friends, Paul knew he wasn't going to live forever. Paul knew he was going to pass off the scene. And he was going to depend the Word of God to men like Timothy and Titus. And so what does he do? Does he say, "Check your doctrines at the door"? Does he say, "I hope you can have your unity in love and learn to get along with everyone who thinks differently"? Oh no, he doesn't say that at all. He says, "Speak thou the things which become sound doctrine." This word "sound doctrine," you know, it means healthy doctrine. It means healthy doctrine. whole doctrine, that the aged men may be sober, grave, temperate, sound in faith, in charity, in patience. The aged women, likewise, that they be in behavior as becometh holiness, not false accusers, not given to much wine, teachers of good things. Verse 4, that they may teach the young women to be sober, to love their husbands, to love their children, to be discreet, chaste, keepers at home, good, obedient to their own husbands, that the word of God be not blasphemed. Young men, likewise, exhort to be sober-minded in all things, showing thyself patterns of good works in doctrine, showing uncorruptedness, gravity, sincerity. He says, in doctrine, showing uncorruptness. Uncorruptness. In other words, what is something corruptible? Something that decays, something that passes away, something that's not good. Yesterday I had the unpleasant job of cleaning out the refrigerator a little bit, and there was some corruption in it, you see. I had to get rid of it. It wasn't nice. Well, friends, we don't want to have doctrine that has corruption in it. We want pure, holy, sweet, good doctrine. That's what we want. Now, what are these effects of sound doctrine? How does this affect us? Because we said, you know, this truth affects us. Our beliefs rule us. They determine who and what we become. The truth will exhort and convince the gainsayer. In Titus chapter 1 and verse 9, it says, holding fast the faithful word, as he hath been taught, that he may be able by sound doctrine both to exhort and to convince the gainsayer. In other words, by healthy doctrine. This word sound doctrine, you know that word sound like we read earlier? It's from a Greek word that we get our English word hygiene from today. Did you know that? It's like healthy, it's sound doctrine, it's clean doctrine, it's pure doctrine. And so he tells us that by healthy doctrine we can encourage and reprove those who are our opponents. That's what he tells us. He doesn't say just simply don't need to love them. We should love all men. Jesus died for all men. All men are precious, and he wants them all to be saved. Doesn't matter if they're alcoholics, he wants them saved. Doesn't matter if they're smoking a carton of cigarettes a week, he wants them saved. Doesn't matter if they have a filthy mouth today, he wants them saved. But friends, he's not going to save them in their filthiness. And the doctrines help us to know what's pure and what's right and what's not. It helps us especially know what sin is. Did you know that? Mm-hmm. The Bible says sin is what? The transgression of the law. 1 John chapter 3, verse 4. And we've been told in spirit of prophecy over and over that this is the only definition of sin found in the Bible. If we don't know what sin is, how can we understand what purity is, friends? Everything becomes a relational theology, a relational gospel. Well, it's just interested in having a relationship with God. You know what? I can go down to the brothel, and I can have a relationship with a harlot. Just having a relationship is not enough, friends. It's got to be the right kind of relationship. And that's based upon understanding our doctrine, understanding who God is and what he is like. Only faith can overthrow false teachings. In 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 18, who concerning the truth have erred, speaking about these two men before, saying that the resurrection is past already and overthrow the faith of some. See, friends, when we don't understand doctrine right, it can overthrow people's faith. Their faith can be overthrown. In John chapter 8, I know we're familiar with verse 32 and we're going to read it, but let's read verse 31 also. John chapter 8, verses 31 and 32. Then said Jesus to those Jews which believed on him, If ye what?
Continue.
Jesus didn't just say, if you hear. Jesus said, if you continue in my word, then are ye my disciples indeed, and ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Friends, the truth will make us free. It certainly will make us free. Because the truth sanctifies. It has sanctifying power. In John chapter 17 and verse 17, sanctify them through thy truth, thy word, to the law and to the testimony. Thy word is truth. We are sanctified through the truth of God, friends. And that is where we find help. For instance, now you think about this. We have many churches today who all teach a doctrine about hell. I was just talking to a man yesterday. He said, I'm going to hell. What difference does it make? Trying to encourage him to quit his tobacco, trying to encourage him to quit his cigarettes and his alcohol. I'm going to hell anyhow. I said, no, you don't have to go to hell. Because the Bible says hell was prepared for the devil and his angels. It was never prepared for any person to ever go to hell. But friends, the sad fact is that many people will go to hell because they have not made their calling and election sure in Christ. They have not understood about the character of God to where they love Him so much that they want to serve Him. But you see, there are doctrines about hell that differ among Christian churches. We know that the most popular common doctrine about hell is that it is an eternally burning torment. And many people, when they hear that idea, they become turned off to God. They say, well, if that's what your God's like, I don't know about that God. I don't know if I want to serve someone like that. Someone that would burn me in hell for as long as he'll burn Adolf Hitler, for instance? Well, I don't think that's a fair kind of guy. I don't think I want to serve him. You see, it affects the way we view people and view God, depending on what we believe ourselves. You know, and one of the things that sometimes that I think it's somewhat of a paradox that we have in our Christianity is this idea about who really God is and who Jesus is. Because I mentioned earlier that most people, when you just take it on face value, most people will tell you, you know, it really is important what you believe about God. Surely we don't believe in the same God as the people of Islam. We don't believe in the same God as the Buddhists. We believe it's important what we believe about God until we get in the realm of Christianity. And then within Christianity, we have all these different ideas about God. And now all of a sudden, well, okay, you got some room to wiggle here. But friends, sometimes the closer the track of truth is to the track of error, the more deceptive it is. Isn't that right?
Amen.
And so we need to understand what the Bible says about these things. I find it interesting, if we turn to the book of Matthew, though, and verse 17, and lo, a voice from heaven saying, this is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. Now, who was speaking in this verse?
Father.
The Father. How many times in the New Testament do you find the Father speaking?
Twice.
Three times. And two of those three times, one's here in Matthew 3:17, the other's in Matthew 17:3, and also in John 12, I believe. But in these first two times, he's stating the fact that Jesus is his Son. He says, Jesus is my Son. We say, well, of course Jesus is the Son. He's the Son of God. But you know what, friends? When you get to asking people, how is Jesus the Son of God? In what way is Jesus the Son of God? Is he really a begotten Son of God? Does he really owe his existence to the Father? They say, well, no, he's not a son like that. He's just a son in a symbolic way. But you know what, friends? The Bible never, ever once says that. It always speaks of this as a literal relationship, just as a father and a son. And I want you to look at a couple other verses in John chapter 3 and verse 16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Now I ask you, friends, this Bible text, which is considered by probably most Christians as the most vital, most important, greatest of all Bible texts, or at least surely one of them, does it really mean what it says? And if it doesn't, then we're saying that Jesus, who spoke these words, really didn't mean what he said. And if Jesus didn't mean what he said, how can we ever trust anything that he said if the most crucial, most important thing he said on our salvation isn't to be trusted, isn't to be understood as he gave it in a very clear, basic, fundamental way? If Jesus was a unique son, a symbolic son, he could have said that. If he was someone just like the Father, but a close associate only, he could have said that. He could have said, I've come from the Father, and he and I are really close friends. But he didn't say that. You know, this God who condemns theatrics, friends, this God who condemns lying and fictitious things, we have been told by many people, bases the plan of salvation on a fictitious lie, that Jesus is really not the Son of God and the Father is really not the Father of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. That these are simply terms of endearment. But that's not what the Bible says. In Matthew chapter 16, going back to Matthew again. Matthew chapter 16. The disciples with Jesus, they came to the coast of Caesarea Philippi. And Jesus asked him the question in verse 13, "Whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?" And they said, "Some say that thou art John the Baptist, some Elias, and others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets." He saith unto them, "But whom say ye that I am?" And friends, that's one of the most important questions that we will answer ourselves to. Who do we think Jesus is? Simon Peter in verse 16 answered and said, "Thou art the Christ." But who is the Christ? He is the Son of the living God. Amen. And Jesus answered him and said, "No, Peter, you're wrong. I'm the second person of the Holy Trinity." That's not what he said? No. Jesus didn't say that. He said, "Blessed art thou, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood hath not revealed this unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven." And Jesus went on and told him, he said, "Upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." And that rock was the teaching that Peter professed. In the book Desire of Ages, on page 412 and 413, Ellen White says on both those pages that this teaching which Peter professed is the foundation of the believer's faith. She says it is the foundation of the church's faith. It is the most important fundamental teaching of all Christianity. And it's either true or it's not. Either our foundation is gone or it is not there. Desire of Ages, page 412 and 413. Desire of Ages. The Apostle Paul, this man who was persecuting Christians, remember this man who was sincere but sincerely wrong? When he got sincerely right, do you know what he started to do? Acts chapter 9 and verse 20. The very first thing Paul began to preach. And straightway, what does that word straightway mean? It's an old English word, immediately. And immediately he preached Christ in the synagogues. What did he preach about Christ? That he is the Son of God. That's what the Apostle Paul preached. So why is this matter? I mean, I'm bringing you an example. I talked to you about the idea of eternal torment in hell a minute ago. Now I'm talking to you about the issue that Jesus is the Son of God. Why is this important? How does this vitally affect our Christian experience? I want to show you one way, at least it does. And that's found in 1 John chapter 4. We'll read verses 8 through 10. "He that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love." God is love. But friends, it's important to be obedient to that love, because the Bible says that the love of God is that we keep His commandments. Isn't that right? But it says God is love. Now notice verse 9 and 10. "In this was manifested or made known the love of God toward us, because that God sent His only begotten Son into the world that we might live through Him. Herein is love, not that we loved God, but that He loved us and sent His Son to be the propitiation for our sins." The Bible says, here's the way. This is the grand test by which we may understand that Jesus is the Son of God. This is the grand test by where we may know that God loves us, and that is that He sent His Son, His only begotten Son, to die for us. Because if you look in verse 19 now, it says there very simply that we love Him because He first loved us. In other words, why should I love God? What is it that, as a Christian, encourages me, propels me, constrains me to love God? It's the fact that He loved me first. Well, how do I know He loved me? Didn't give me a Mercedes-Benz. I don't have $1,000 in the bank to my name. How do I know He loved me, friends? I've had two children die. How do I know He loves me? He gave His only begotten Son. He gave His only begotten Son. I'm going to tell you, from having an only begotten Son die, and watch Him die, and watch Him suffer, I can tell you there's something that's awfully painful about that. Something that wrenches your heart like nothing else in this world can. God, who loves perfectly, who loved His Son worthy of being loved perfectly, gave His Son to die for me. He gave His Son to die for you. And if that doesn't pull your heartstrings, friends, it's one thing to give a friend, it's one thing to give an associate, maybe even one great thing to give a brother or a sister, but friends, He gave His only begotten Son. And that's what the Bible says. And if you deny that, you deny what the Word of God says very plainly. How does the papacy view this point? I want to show you prophetically what the papacy would do to this point in Daniel chapter 7. Because after all, what you believe affects how you are. Daniel chapter 7. I'm going to read verses 8 in the book of Daniel, the 7th chapter, four great beasts come up out of the sea, diverse from one another. These four beasts are what? Four kings or kingdoms which shall arise upon the earth, right? But the fourth beast is a little interesting because it has what? 10 horns? And yet then there comes up a little horn, which is distinct and different from the 10, you remember? And this little horn does all kinds of things. But notice what one of the great characteristics of this little horn power is in verse 8. I considered the horns, and behold, there came up among them another little horn, before whom there were three of the first horns plucked up by the roots. Do you see here, friends, that one of the identifying marks of this little horn power, in fact, the very first one that's given, is that it plucks up three of these others by the roots. And you know, as Adventists, we have studied the history on this. And we know that of these 10 nations that came out of Rome, that made up what we call Europe today, these 10 tribes, that there were three, and three of them were the Huralis, the Ostrogoths, and the Vandals. Remember, you've heard those before, haven't you? And why was it, friends, that these three were uprooted? Well, I remember hearing so oftentimes when I heard Elder Joe Cruz preach, and I heard him preach about this several times, this particular prophecy. And as he was talking about these prophecies, you know, Brother Joe could preach pretty rapid fire. He says, well, these three powers, they were Arian powers. They denied the doctrine of the Trinity. And so the papacy took them away. They denied the doctrine of the Trinity. They were non-Trinitarian powers. Now, there's been a lot of misalignment about what these people really believed. And I don't think they've been given a very fair shake in some of the histories. Because some people have tried to make it out like that they denied the divinity of Christ, but they didn't. But what they did deny was the doctrine of the Trinity. They denied the power that established the Trinity and that promulgated the Trinity. And that power is the papacy, friends. The Trinity doctrine is a brainchild of the papacy. It's interesting, I found this quotation on a website, Amazing Discoveries website, and it was a quotation about it was to uproot three, and that quotation says this: three kingdoms that did not accept the papal mandates regarding Christ's divinity were literally uprooted and mercilessly destroyed. Although the doctrine of the divinity of Christ was correct, the method of dealing with it was not. That's Professor Walter J. Veith, PhD, according to the way he labels it on his website. Now I want to ask you a question. Shouldn't correct doctrine lead to correct living? Mm-hmm. You mean they had the correct doctrine, but it taught them to be murderers? I don't think so. Friends, these people didn't deny the divinity of Christ. There are people who today say that our Adventist pioneers denied the divinity of Christ because they didn't believe in the Trinity, but that is not true. It is not true at all. In fact, there was a book published in 1884, The Atonement in the Light of Nature and Revelation. I have actually a copy. There's a picture of my copy. This was published by written by J.H. Wagoner. He was one of those early Adventist pioneers from the earliest days of the 1844 movement. His son became probably far better known than he, E.J. Wagoner. And they wrote this book called The Atonement. And this book, as you can see here, this is the title page, and I'll zoom in just a little bit for you. It was published in the year 1884. Do you get the date? 1884. And here's part of what is in that book. Wagoner says, many theologians really think that the atonement, in respect to its dignity and efficacy, rests upon the doctrine of a Trinity. But we fail to see any connection between the two. To the contrary, the advocates of that doctrine really fall into the difficulty which they seem anxious to avoid. Their difficulty consists in this. They take the denial of a Trinity to be equivalent to a denial of the divinity of Christ. Were that the case, we should cling to the doctrine of a Trinity as tenaciously as any can, but it is not the case. Continuing, he says, those who have read our remarks on the death of the Son of God know that we firmly believe in the divinity of Christ, but we cannot accept the idea of a Trinity as it is held by Trinitarians without giving up our claim on the dignity of the sacrifice made for our redemption. And then he goes on to say, as before remarked, The great mistake of Trinitarians in arguing this subject is this. They make no distinction between a denial of a Trinity and a denial of the divinity of Christ. And that's taken from this book, The Atonement, on pages 164 and 165. Also, some of this material was published in the Review and Herald of November 10, 1863, which was under the editorship of Elder James White at that time. In other words, he says, we do not understand the Trinitarian doctrine as necessary to uphold the divinity of Christ. We believe in the divinity of Christ without believing in this concept called the Trinity, just like those people did in the Urals, the Ostrogoths, and the Vandals. But now, interestingly, what year did we say that this statement was published, this book was published? 1884. And by the way, this was a standard book in the denomination for many years. This was a denominational standard. It wasn't just something that was done and put on a shelf in one or two homes. This was a big book in the Adventist Church at that time, 1884. Now I'd like to read to you something from the Spirit of Prophecy. And this was penned in 1881, 3 years before. Okay? This is in Volume 4 of the Testimonies on page 592. We have been receiving fresh assurance that we have the truth as revealed in the Word of God, that in accepting the third angel's message, we have not given heed to fables, but to the sure word of prophecy. We are now living in the full blaze of the light of Bible truth. And friends, their teachings hadn't changed between 1863 and 1884 on this issue. Wagner was teaching the same thing all the way through. James White was teaching it. Uriah Smith was teaching it. Joseph Bates was teaching it. Loughborough was teaching it. Jan Andrews was teaching it. You name them. If they were living at that time in Adventism, they were teaching the same thing. And Ellen White says in 1881 that we've been receiving fresh assurances that the truth we have is the truth of God. In fact, she went on just a little later in that same testimony on page 595, and she said this, "It is as certain that we have the truth as that God lives. And Satan, with all his arts and hellish power, cannot change the truth of God into a lie. Why, the great adversary will try his utmost to make of none effect the word of God. Truth must go forth as a lamp that burneth." Now, friends, we understand that prophecy is an unrolling scroll. And there were certain elements of prophecy that those men couldn't have understood at that time because the scroll hadn't unrolled so far. But friends, concerning the fundamental pillars, the fundamentals, and that's why they called those things the principles of fundamental beliefs, concerning those fundamental beliefs, they had it down, and God gave it to them early. And Ellen White attests that we have the truth as sure as God lives. But I want to tell you, friends, if they were off in such a vital area as knowing who God is and knowing who Jesus Christ is, how in the world could she make that kind of a statement, honestly, truthfully, and the whole face? She couldn't, and she can't. Friends, it matters. All this matters because it affects the kind of people that we're going to be. It affects the way we live. If you ask anyone who studies systematic theology, understanding the doctrine of Christ, understanding the doctrine of sin, we talked about sin just a minute ago a little bit. If you get off on those fundamental issues, there is no way that you can get the rest of it right because you're building on the wrong foundation, and it does affect the way you are. And I want to tell you, friends, you look at it historically. Anywhere that the doctrine of the Trinity has been denied, persecution has always followed. It has always followed. And there's a reason for that. In Matthew chapter 15, if we could turn there, in verse 9, Jesus says, "But in vain do they worship me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men." You know, friends, I'm sorry. I don't care how sincere we are. I don't care how sincere you are. Sincerity is wrong if it's false teachings. If it's the teachings of man, Jesus says it leads to vain worship. I believe, friends, with all my heart that God looks upon our ignorance with kindness. And he winks at it, but he says, "Now the days of ignorance is past. And it's time to come into the truth and to follow the truth." Because, friends, closing our ears or playing an ostrich as it is will not help us. in Proverbs chapter 28 and verse 9. The wise man says, "He that turneth away his ear from hearing Torah, even his prayer shall be abomination." He who turns his ear away from hearing the law, the Hebrew is Torah. The Torah. All the law. All the prophets. When we turn our ear away, when we play ostrich or act like this doesn't matter, our prayers, friends, cannot effectively reach God. Because we're trying to play games with Him and He knows better. And He's not going to allow us to do that. He's too good to us to do that. Truth received, only truth received into the intellect, friends, is not enough. If we receive the truth intellectually, as a textbook fact, it will not sanctify anyone, friends. It has to be lived in us. Jesus said we must continue in that word. We must not only believe it, we must live it. It must become a part of us. In Testimonies for the Church, Volume 1, on page 274, we are told that the truth, it brings him up, refines his taste, sanctifies his judgment, and if lived out, is continually fitting him for the society of holy angels in the city of God. You see, friends, the truth has to be lived out in our lives. It just can't be something that we hear. It matters. It matters what we believe, and it matters if we hear it and then follow up on it. Friends, there is a fearful warning given in the Bible to those who would reject God's message. In 2 Thessalonians, if we turn back to some of Paul's writings again, 2 Thessalonians, speaking about this mystery of iniquity, with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they receive not the love of the truth that they might be saved. And for this cause God shall send them strong delusion that they shall believe a lie, that they should believe a lie, and that they all might be damned who believe not the truth, but have pleasure in unrighteousness. Friends, the mystery of iniquity, the mystery of iniquity, in one word, one answer, one word, the mystery of iniquity, who? The papacy, Rome. Do you deny that? Do you have any question about that? I don't, not for a moment. And the central pillar, the central doctrine, the central pillar of Catholic faith is the doctrine of the Trinity, by the way. And I think that this warning, friends, has a special application against false teachings about God. That they all might be damned who believe not the truth. Well, the truth about what? The truth about God. The truth about His character and that He is who He is and how He fits into our picture. In 1 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 1, "Now the Spirit speaketh expressly, that in the latter times some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils." Friends, if the doctrine doesn't come from God, where does it come from? It comes from the devil. And I don't want that. But friends, I want to tell you something. The good news is that the gates of heaven are opened to everyone who knows the truth and wants to keep that truth. I was down talking to Shaky yesterday, Kevin. I said, "You need to get rid of those cigarettes." "Oh," I said, "I know." I said, "Why don't you let me take them? I'll get them out of here for you." "No, you just take them so you'll smoke them." I said, "No, you know I won't, don't you?" He said, "Yeah, I know you won't." He said, "But there's other people who do." You know, we know it's wrong to smoke, but then we keep doing it. Did that knowledge help that man? Does the knowledge that he knows alcohol is killing his liver, tearing him up, keep him from drinking of himself? No, friends, he's got to walk in that truth. He's got to fulfill that truth. But I want to tell you what it says in Isaiah chapter 26 and verse 2. I like this verse. I hope you do too. Let's read verse 1 also. "In that day shall this song be sung in the land of Judah. We have a strong God. Salvation will God appoint for walls and bulwarks. Open ye the gates, that the righteous nation which believeth the truth may enter in." Yeah. It doesn't say that the righteous nation that believeth the truth, does it? It says there's a righteous nation that does what? They keep the truth. They keep the truth. Friends, it's not enough to check our doctrines at the door. It's not enough to just love in unity. I'm sorry, that doesn't cut it. That's not going to open the gates in heaven. Blessed are they that do His commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life and enter into the gates into the city, Revelation 22:14. That's where truth is to be found. And that's where truth leads us. And Jesus, in John chapter 14, verse 6, is the way, the truth, and life. And who is Jesus? Friends, He's the Son of God. It matters. It matters because salvation matters. May God bless you lots and lots.